Hi there, welcome in the showroom of Mimaki in Amsterdam. In this video, Jordi and I would like to show you how to get the most out of our latest 3D printer, the Mimaki 3D GD 1800.
This machine can print 3D objects up to 1.8 meters high. And thanks to its gel dispensing technology, it's really fast. So that's why the 3D GD 1800 is the perfect machine for the sign market. Making billboards, real-life models, molds for vacuum forming and channel letters. Today, we want to bring our own ID to life, a promotional ice cream. Let's start working on it. If you want to print big, and you want to print big and fast, the 3D GD 1800 is the perfect machine for you. And like you would expect from Mimaki, you can always count on our worldwide Mimaki dealer network.
So now we will enjoy a real ice cream. Thank you for watching.
So, good morning, everybody. Welcome to this webinar of the 3D GD 1800 printer, the biggest 3D printer in Mimaki's portfolio. I would like to ask Jordi to switch on his webcam as well, so I can introduce him. You saw him already during the movie. I hope you enjoyed that that movie. So here is Jordi. Both of us will do the presentation. I will start with the machine itself. There we are. Then I will explain a few housekeeping rules. We do the landscape of Mimaki, so we have already quite some lineup of different technologies in 3D printing. Then I will go to the machine itself, show some insights of the machine, how it is exactly working. And then most likely for you guys, the most important and nicest part is Jordi will explain to start with the ice cream, the full work process, the workflow, how we did it, what is needed, what is necessary, where to look to. And he will also have another example. Basically, the ice cream is a very simple object. We also have a nice example which he is explaining with a more complex object. And then we will end, as always, with a Q&A. So if you have questions during this webinar, please, you have a chat function with GoToWebinar tool. So just type in your question, and at the end, we will try to follow up all the questions live here during this webinar. So the housekeeping rules as always, so basically everybody is muted. We are recording the session, so later on you can always find the recording back on our website. And like I said, if there are any questions, please type them and we will collect them here and we'll try to answer them all at the end of the webinar. So first, can you switch to the next slide? So first introduction of myself. My name is Bert Benkhuizen. I'm the product manager for Mimaki for EMEA at Europe. And like I said, Jordi is our 3D application specialist, focused only on the 3D printers. So let's start with the landscape, 3D landscape of Mimaki. And we have at this moment four machines in our portfolio. So the first one is a small FDM printer. It's 3DFF 222. So basically, we introduced this machine mainly as an additional tool for our UGF customers, 2D flatbed printers, for creating jigs for the small giveaways like pens or lighters, which is much more easier to print. Then recently, we announced the 3D UG 2207. This is basically the small brother of the 3D UG 553, which is our largest full color, over 10 million color 3D printer, ideal for prototyping figurines. This kind of full color of work, the 3D UG 2207, the smaller one, like I said, is recently introduced and is really getting into the possibilities for the smaller printers price wise. A very nice new printer, which completes basically a big part of all those full color 3D objects you can print. And then for today, we have the biggest one, the 3D GD 1800. Like seen on the movie, it is a huge machine. It's up to 1.8 meters high. And it's not FDM, it's not ink yet like the others, but this is a gel which we are dispensing, and the gel is cured by UV light. I will explain that later to you. So if we have a look to the complete machine, the outside of the machine, of course we have a touch panel where all the jobs can be activated and prepared for the printing. Like I said, we are using gel, so the tank with gel, it's a 19 kilo tank, is placed inside the machine. There are double doors to open in front and in the back, so it makes it very accessible to go inside or do a cleaning, and it gives easy access to the printed objects. It's a huge machine. So basically the build size, table size, and the maximum printing size you can do is 1.45 meters by 1.1 meters in depth. And like I said, the height is 1.8 meters. So that's really a big printer for big objects, which comes very close to our sign making market, which I will show you later on. And of course we have the electrical cabinet with all the electrical parts, of course. What maybe is more interesting is if you look at the inside of the machine. So basically we are using print heads. We have two print heads that are dispensing the gel onto the table. It is a big table, vacuum table. It is going up and down. During printing, of course, it starts in the top position, and with each and every layer of the gel, the vacuum table will lower for the next layer. Also, those two print heads can work independently from each other. So you can basically print two different jobs at the same time. Or if you have a big job, you can always slide that in two parts and print one job, split it to gain a lot of time. Next to the print heads, we have the UV lamps that are curing directly after dispensing. So the gel is directly hard and dry, and it has its strong characteristics, which is needed for such large objects that we are printing. So we are talking about gel dispensing printing technology. So here you see a close-up of a print head. So we are dispensing in layers the gel, and we have then the UV LED lamps that are curing or drying, hardening the gel. And thinking about the speed, also in the movie, it was big and fast. So we calculated the maximum, or basically not the maximum printing speed, but the printing speed when we would print a 1 meter diameter cylinder, and then the speed is 350 millimeters per hour. So basically everything that is smaller could be faster. So we are curing with UV light like we do with our flatbed printers, and also our roll-to-roll printers where we use ink, which we are curing with UV light. In this case, we use the gel. We can print without supports, so it's quite strong material, but of course there are some objects that need support. Jordi will show you also in his presentation when support is needed. Different from our inkjet technology, where we also are jetting support material that can be removed afterwards, we don't have this with this gel technology. So basically we are improving productivity and reduction of material waste because we don't have any support removal or infill. Like I said, we have two print heads with two different nozzles. You can choose which nozzle diameter you can install in the machine. The machine comes with our own slicer software, the 3D GD slicer. And basically, depending on the surface smoothness you want to choose, we have three different modeling modes. So we have a normal mode of 1.3 millimeter, basically that's the layer thickness that we are dispensing. We have a quality mode for 1 millimeter layer thickness and the high resolution with 0.8 millimeters. And like I said, with the 1 meter diameter cylinder, the speed is quite amazing. It is 350 millimeters per hour. So Mimaki is a company that exists over 40 years. And basically we are one of the key players in different sectors than 3D. So basically we have four different segments within our company. The first one is ISG, which stands for sign making. So everything that has to do with advertising, billboards, car wraps, this kind of work. We have a large portfolio of different machines, different technologies, different inks to offer. Another one which comes more closer to the 3D technology is the UV lineup, the flatbed printers. We have large and small models. This is our IP business unit, which stands for industrial products. So also here we are using UV inks and we are curing that also with UV light. Then we have a big lineup of different textile printers. And last but not least, we have the, I think since 3 years now, the 3D printers in our portfolio. And we would like to be also one of the key players in the 3D market for the future. Like we have that in the other segments that I showed you. So that was briefly my story about the machine. So I will switch to Jordi. He has some very nice explanations about the whole print process using the ice cream and a different object. So Jordi, it's all yours.
Okay, thank you Bert for this nice introduction. Let's see, everything is on. My name is Jordi Driemann and I'm the 3D application specialist at Mimaki Europe. And today I'm going to explain a little bit more about the print process with the 3D GD 1800 and of course the post-process possibilities. So at first, why do we want to post-process the models that are printed with the 3D GD 1800? It's to give them, as an example, more strength and reinforcement.
to give them a better surface finish, protection against the weather elements, and for construction and assembly purpose. Finally, we want to give them a nice finish. So it's obviously that we are giving them a nice post-processing for a decorative purpose. And we advise to use our 2D Mimaki technology to improve that. So your applications will be better. As before, Bert already explained, you can use our signage 2D printers and using a wrapping foil, shrink film, or illuminated fabric. If you have an IP 2D printer, we advise to use thermoformic film. With the textile apparel printers, you can use the fabrics. And if you have already a 3D printer, you can use them to give them a really nice high detail full color finish to give you big object some extra details. So I'm gonna explain more about the common methods you can use. So at first, I will go in more in depth about the shrink film you can use on the 3D objects, the illuminated fabric, the final wrapping process, and the vacuum forming. Of course, there are a lot more post-processing methods you can use with our technology. Basically sanding and painting, flocking, so give it a little furry on the outside of the object. You can chrome or metal paint the objects. It's also possible to use a displacement map, like a 3D texture. Stone spray is also a nice finish. It gives a really nice stone look. And of course, you can use the 3D models as a mold and fill them with concrete. Another technology is also possible, that is displaying or projecting light on the objects to color them. So let's go over and tell you more about the shrink film option. With the shrink film option, first you need to have the 3D object and print the shrink film on a normal 2D printer. It's highly recommend to use the right type of ink with this process. And when you have the shrink film, you can easily wrap it around the object by using using simple heat. And this is a really fast way to give you relative simple objects and a nice smooth look. With the illuminated fabric, it's necessary that you print the frame already in the 3D object, as you can see here. And from there, it's quite easy to print the fabric and apply it quite fast on the object to give it a really nice finish. In this example, we used a simple LED module behind the fabric to illuminate it. Final wrapping. We will go more in depth on this later, but here you use wrapping final to give the object a really fast color finish. And in this case, it's not necessary to smooth the object before, because the final will make the object more smooth itself. Another technology that's quite often used is the vacuum forming technology with the 3D GD 1800. And in this case, the film is printed mostly on a flatbed printer, and we are using a vacuum forming machine to to form the plastic around the 3D model. Now let's go more into depth on the ice cream you already saw in the introduction video. The ice cream is a more simple object. It's a basic object that only consists out of three parts. But let's show how the workflow is being done with that with this object. So here you have an overview of the total workflow. So it first starts with an ID, and from there you need to have the 3D file. The 3D file needs to be adjusted accordingly to make it printable. And sometimes you also need to cut it and make multiple parts of it. And from there, the slicing process starts. You start with printing. And after that, the post-processing takes place. First starts with support removal, smoothing. Afterwards, adding an internal structure to make the object more stronger. And coloring. In this case, we're gonna wrap the object, and from there the installation takes place. You need to assemble the object, you need to display it, and finally you need to dismantle it for shipping to for shipping it to the customer. Because this is a simple object, we don't need to smooth the 3D file. Because on forehand we kind of design the file so that there is no need for smoothing. Support removal is therefore also not needed, because we designed the ice cream in that way that there is no need for support material. So this saves time. We're gonna use a wrapping vinyl. So smoothing in this case is also not necessary as end step, and because it's standing on the floor, we don't use any mechanical structure to reinforce this object. So let's start with the ID. So we had ID to make a nice ice cream that will attract people. And of course, we want to have our logo be visible on it. The idea was to make an ice cream that sticks into the ground, and because of the heat of the sun, it needs to look like it's melting. We want people to bump into this object to attract them, and therefore we were thinking that a size of 1.2 meters is high enough. As said before, we're gonna place the ice cream on the floor, so there's no support needed or any hanging structure, and we're gonna wrap it with printed vinyl because we don't want to smooth the whole object. So we use the 3D GD, we use a 2D Mimaki printer, and this is giving an ID of the final end result we want to achieve. To make the 3D model, you are free to use common 3D design software. In this case, we used SketchUp to make the model, but Blender, Autodesk Fusion, or ZBrush, or any other 3D common design software will do the job in this case. And because we want to do the printing quite easy and not use any support structures, we split the object into three parts, or to be precise, in four parts, because the stick we also cut it in half to make the to make the print process more easy. We also need in the post-processing stage, we need to have a texture for the wrapping foil. In this case, we downloaded, we searched for the image on Shutterstock, and we placed the logo on it. We modified the ice cream texture, so there will be a difference between the molten part and the still cold part of the ice. Now we used the GV100 with the eco solvent, and we laminated the final on the LA160W from Imaki. Now from there, we had every file and the 3D files ready. So we went over to our slicing program, the 3DGD slicing software. And there you can see that you can position the files on the table. You can see if there is any need for support material, but in this case, it was not necessary. And as you can see, it gives you the amount of material that it will use and also the printing time. So upfront, you already can estimate how long it will take to print this. And then we started printing. And as you can see, we print the big part. And as you can see, the total print time of all the objects was about 10 hours. And all the objects are printed without support material. After that, we did the wrapping of the object. That took us like 4 hours, and we used 5 meters of wrapping foil and laminate. But to give you an idea about the cost of this object, we make a nice overview where you can see all the materials and material costs and our costs, like labor. So we estimate that to create this ice cream with the 3DGD 1800, it will cost you around 2,500 euro. And in this case, we also did a little comparison. Our method was the digital method with the 3D 1800. And we spent around 2,500 euro on this ice cream. And we also find out and did some investigation how much it will cost if you use a conventional method to create this ice cream. And we came around with numbers we find out that in a low labor country, if you want to have something like this ice cream with this scale, and it can be painted, or it can also be used with wrapping foil, that you need to think of 8,500 euros to create something like this. So basically, you can print 3 ice creams for the same price as a normal or an old conventional method where they are using glass fiber to create such an object. Now, to give you more an idea, this is a relatively simple object, but we also investigated and made a sample of a more complex object. And with a more complex object, you really need the 3D print technology, because otherwise you need to make a lot of molds, and it's almost impossible. That's not the right word, but it's very expensive to do that. I want to show you also the workflow in how to make a complex object. Here we are. We started with the same workflow. We also need to do it. We need to create and discuss the ID. We need to retrieve the 3D file. And in this case, we're gonna definitely gonna use the smoothing, support removal, the smoothing of the 3D objects in the post process. We really need them, and we also need to strengthen the object, so adding an internal structure. So let's first start with the ID. In this case, we want to make a nice sample that that's giving a real impact on the sign and graphic industry. So that's recognizable by everybody. So we were thinking, okay, it needs to be big. It needs to be a big crab hanging on a wall with a dimension across 2 meters. We already found out that we want to hang it permanent indoors. So we don't need to worry about sunlight and that kind of things. There will be no human interaction. So no human will sit on the object. So that's in the post-process stage important. So you know how strong the object needs to be. And yeah, we're gonna hang it on the wall as a sign with a nice background visual. As a finishing, we wanted to use a normal paint, a spray paint or a polyurethane paint. So in this case, we were searching the internet to get a nice model. And yeah, we found a free 3D model. So there we saved already some money. We found it on TurboSquid, and it's a crab in STL format. That's the 3D format you want to have with the 3D GD 1800. Most important is that if you are searching for a 3D model on the internet, you need to search for models that can be easily printed on the 3D GD, because you are printing quite big with a large nozzle. So if you are searching, for a model with too many details, it's almost impossible to print that on a large format 3D printer. So it saves you a lot of time if you find the right model that suits your application and suits your 3D printer. Now, so we started with this crab, and from there we used a 3D program, Materialize Magix, to cut it into different parts, because it's not handy to print it as one. So we used the cutting tool, and as you can see here, we made we cut it in 24 pieces to make the printing more easy and efficient. From there, as I already mentioned, this object was still having too much detail. And our slicer software was adding a lot of support material to it. And yeah, that's not what we want to have. So what we did, we used ZBrush, and we used the basic smoothing option there to smooth the object, to give it less detail. And here you can see that our slicing software firstly wanted to add a lot of internal support roofs. And after smoothing, the roofs weren't necessary anymore. So yeah, this saved us a lot of printing time and a lot of printing material. From there, we went over to our slicing software. And as my colleague Bert already mentioned, with this machine, support material is not necessary, but if you have really small objects, like the small, like the claw of the crab, you need to add some extra support, because otherwise the connection area between the part and the print bed is too low, and your model will basically fall over during printing. You also see here on the first picture that the slicing software is adding the red areas, so it automatically is adding we call it micro support structures on the inside. So that's automatically done by our printer. the support structures you see on the smaller parts, they are placed by hand. So yeah, long narrow parts require more support for stabilization. Now, the total print time of the complete grab will be around 14 hours and 30 minutes. Because the 3D GD 1800 is having two print heads, we can print more efficient, and a lot of the small parts are printed on one print bed. So when we are using both print heads, it saves us half the time. So finally, the total printing hours took 7 hours and 10 minutes, and we used 14.14 kilograms of material. Now, during printing, it's not necessary to stay by the printer to watch how he's doing everything. The printer is fitted with a camera next to the print head, so it's quite easily to use TeamViewer to monitor the whole print process, and you can already work on the next project. So you keep your printer up and running the whole time. When the print was finished, it was necessary to remove all the support structures we added. And you can do that by hand or using a nipper. Here you can see that they will break off quite easily. In some cases, it's necessary to send those parts, because small areas, they are not that smooth. So you can use a router or a grinder to remove the remaining support material. And if it are really small parts, it's really advisable to do that, because otherwise it will break. From there, we started with smoothing the object. So we applied a lot of putty, car filler, and we sanded the whole structure. Here you can see on the big part, the top surface is not that nice, so there we needed to apply some extra work. Here we can see we filled all the grooves with putty, and from there we sanded it with an orbital sander. And finally, we sprayed all the objects with a polyurethane primer, and from there we could start with filling the internal structures of the objects, because they are all hollow. So all the parts needed to be connected to each other. So we used some steel bars and polyurethane foam to connect and bond all those parts. You can use the UV gel to glue the parts. And here you can see on the inside, while we are pouring the polyurethane foam, the expanding foam, to give the object a more rigid reinforcement, we also use the PVC pipes to make it more strong, and it will be hang on the wall. So this will give you more object more body. Now you can see the final parts. Because we used a lot of small parts, it's advisable to label all those parts, because otherwise you get confused and you don't know how to connect the parts anymore. And if you are using a lot of UV gel as a glue, the inside or the middle part of the gel will not cure, because the UV light will not pass on the already cured outside. So if you need to glue larger parts, it's really advisable to use a two-part epoxy glue and only use the gel for quick bonds. Now, that was all done. So we started with spraying all the objects. In this case, we used acrylic urethane paint. And finally, over that, we top coated it with clear urethane spray. This was of course done by a professional painters company. So we gonna place the crab on the wall, and the wall is around 3 meters wide. So we used the UCGV 300 to print the wallpaper. In this case, it was sticky wallpaper. This was done fairly easy, and finally we assembled the crab and mounted it on the wall. And in this case, we used it. We used a clear acrylic plate to mount all the small legs together. And finally, we assembled it and placed it on the wall. And that was the complex workflow. So that was it.
Thank you, Jordi. Well done, and a very nice example. Let's go to the Q&A session. I will switch on the camera. So commenting a little bit on what Jordi's workflow was all about. There is a big difference between a simple object price-wise and workflow-wise than this complex one. And like Jordi showed in the calculation, with a simple object as an ice cream, which is basically conventional, more easy to make. So you have, let's say, in this case, three printers printed by 3D printing, which gives you a break even with conventional methods. You can imagine that such a crap, if you need to make that conventional in molds, then you're talking about so many more 3D printed objects, which is then still more profitable to do. So also what for me is kind of an eye opener compared to the other 3D printers that we have is that there is really a lot of work involved, labor work, post-processing, pre-processing before you can print. So that's definitely something you need to consider in case if you are interested in such technology. So it's not that what we are used to is with our 3D553, our full color printer, once the 3D data and the color texture is placed on the object, the object comes out of the printer, you put it in a tank of water, the support removal has been placed, and you don't have to do anything anymore. You have a ready object. That is with this technology just a different story. So we received not that many questions, I have to say, so indicating I think that your story was very clear. So the first question I saw, can you scroll up, Marianne, please? That's the one from Douglas. I think you explained it already a little bit. So he was wondering why you didn't print the ice cream in one big part and why you divided that in three different pieces.
Yeah, that's something that has to do with the surface where we print on glass. So if you, for example, take the liquid part, we print it upside down. So when the print is finished, you have a really nice smooth surface. And because all the parts are printed hollow, so they don't have any internal structure, you need to think of how to print those parts efficient. So if we wanted to print the whole ice cream as one part, it would take double the time because you need to arrange it in a way, adding a lot of support structure because the liquid was hollow. So it makes sense to double check your 3D layout and search for the most efficient way to print it. And in this case, it was quite easy. We said, okay, let's print it in let's split it into three or four parts and do a little bit of assembling afterwards. So for every application, yeah, you need to find the most efficient way, and you can better spend half an hour more on the printing layout than having 2 hours or 3 hours extra printing time in this case.
Okay, thank you. Then we have a question from my big friend from Greece, Stratis. The last time I was there, we went to a seafood restaurant, Stratis, if you remember. so you would have liked the samples that we showed. He is asking if the ice cream was not solid inside. So it was like only the outer shell. Would it be faster? But I think it was it was not solid.
It was not solid. No, no. With the 3D GD, almost every object is printed without infill. You will have the really big speed. Eh? So we can print a big cylindrical shape of 1 meter in diameter, and we can print up to 35 centimeters an hour. We only can achieve that by not using any infill. If you want to use any infill, do it in afterwards in the post process, as we already explained, with polyurethane foam. That's much, much faster than printing the infill on the 3D printer itself.
And cheaper, I guess.
And cheaper, yeah.
Yeah, that's also an important one. And I think also when you need some enforcement, so extra strength, you can design that during the 3-day data preparation to make bridges or something to make it stronger, yeah?
Yeah, that's correct. In our slicing software, it's fairly easy to, we call that ribs. So you can add an extra pair of ribs inside your model to make it stronger. If you have a really complex object and with big gaps, then you need to fill that with one or two ribs to be sure that it's strong enough during printing, and afterwards you're gonna fill that with polyurethane expanding foam again. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that answer. Then we have several questions from Beka. Thank you for asking them. So he is wondering about the two-head print heads possibility. So he is asking if it is possible to duplicate parts or print two different parts at the same time. So basically, I can answer that. You can do different parts. The only thing that you need to consider is that both print heads has an independent Z-X, and in case if the difference is less than 16 centimeters, they can print all kinds of different objects at the same time.
Otherwise it will slow down the bigger part.
Yes, because so it will wait for the bigger part.
Yes.
So how thick is the diameter of the print material? So I think that is basically the wall thickness, I think Gary is referring to.
Yeah, there are a couple of options on that. Depending on what kind of nozzle you are using, we have a 1.8 millimeter and a 2.6 millimeter nozzle. And depending on what kind of nozzle you are using, you can select in our slicer software a double parameter, so a double wall thickness. We have a special option that's mega, so then it's making the wall even thicker. So it depends on your application. So if you have a small part and you want to have a high detail, you will use the 1.8 millimeter nozzle with a relative small wall thickness, so the resolution will be better. If you have a real big object and it also needs to be strong, then you are using the 2.6 millimeter nozzle with a double wall thickness. In that case, it needs to print the object twice because it's laying a double perimeter as a wall. Yeah.
Okay, then we have a question from Slomo coming in. So during the printing process, in which stage you are adding the supports from the start?
Yes. Yeah, this the slicing software doesn't have any infill capabilities. So you need to be aware that every support that's needed, and the slicer will mark those areas in red. Yeah, there you need to apply the support material yourself, and it can be simple ribs or more advanced structures to support your object. Yeah, but it's done in front with the slicing, so it's not that you load the 3D model and you slice it and then you start printing. No, you need to find out the most efficient way to print your object and add the support structure over there. So yeah, there are certain rules to yeah, to do that. Yeah.
So a little bit going further on this topic, question from Ertan. Can the software calculate before building a 3D model whether support is needed for the parts?
Yes, we have so while you are positioning the model and slicing it and find out what kind of print settings you want, we also have a mode where you can view. It's called the probability of success. So it will mark the areas with a color. So red, yeah, it will get your attention, because there you need to add support material. So yeah, you need to do it yeah, in front, and you need to do it before while slicing, and the software is having some special modes to show you where you need to place the support.
Okay, now many questions are coming in there, mm-hmm. So that's good to see. We have some time, so that's good. An interesting one from Alex. The gel is used to print is similar to a conventional PRA or PETG, ABS, or similar. So yeah. It's more about the characteristics and the strength of the gel after curing.
Yeah, I think you can... The gel is a little bit brittle, so it sits between PLA and ABS. It's not like PETG, but yeah, it's really sitting between all those materials. So yeah, it looks a little bit like PLA, but it's having the strength of ABS. So that's where you need to think of. Yeah, it's not comparable like that.
Okay, then a question from Dragos. How many types of materials are available? How many kilo of installation at installation? So basically, and the replacement procedure. So I will do the first two questions and then you can answer the last one. So basically, we have two different gels. One is a white gel, the other one is more transparent. And they come in a tank of 19 kilos. So basically that is, you saw the big parts that we printed, which were about 15 kilos of gel. Yep. So basically one full tank should be enough, but in case if it runs out during printing, it is easy to swap and it will continue without any problems.
Yeah, we have a hot swap mode, so during print it will slow down a little bit, and then you have time to replace the bucket on the side of the printer. And if you want to go home in the evening and you want to pause the print process, then we also have a special mode for that. So yeah, there is a mode where you can replace the empty bucket fairly easy.
Okay. The question from Gloria. Hi, Jordi and Bert. Hi, Gloria. The 3DGD 1800 is able to recreate any type of object or shape. And what are the limitations?
Yeah, there are many limitations. I think we cannot cover them all, but as with any 3D print process, we cannot print in thin air, so you need a support structure. But one of the special things of this 3D printer is, and because we are using gel, is that we can print horizontal. So if you have like a cylinder and you want to close the top surface, that's possible with this printer without support material. It will finish it. But yeah, I think we need to send you an email and have a discussion about that.
Okay, I see a question from Uwe Niklas, our former colleague from Germany. Welcome, Uwe. Nice to see you online. His question is about the resistance, especially outdoors, so the color fastness. Yeah, that depends, of course. So the gel itself is white. You need an finishing. So depending on the finishing you are choosing, and we show the wrapping. So average the wrapping with our eco-solvent inks are, let's say, up to 3 years. Before you see a noticeable color fading, in case you are doing a painting job, it lasts overall a little bit longer. So I think that depends really on the post-processing and the choice of the coloring that you have for that certain project. Let me check which we have more. A question from Maria. It's about the product launch presentation of the 3D UG 2207. Definitely, Maria, the moment that the printer becomes closer to the commercial availability of the machine, we will also organize a webinar for this extreme interesting printer as well. So I think we are getting closer to the targeted application market from Gary. Yes. Yeah, the applications are, let's say, as long as your imagination is getting you. We, of course, as Mimaki, we have a very close connection and a huge network in the design graphics market. So companies that are working for exhibitions, stores, those big signage that you sometimes see in stores or outside the store. This connects very quickly to our Mimaki end users, which have Mimaki 2D, let's call it 2D printers here these days. With 3D possibilities are extreme. You can make with the 3D printer objects that basically are impossible with even a 5D access router machine. Just use your imagination and you will find a 3D printer that basically can do any job. Did you find any question, Jordi? So once we started, we had 5 questions. I think now we are over 40. Is limited.
I see one.
So let's do down the last one, and the rest we will. At least we will answer all the questions personally back by email today or tomorrow. For this Q&A session, it's up to Jordi which question to pick.
Yeah, I think the last one from Sabine is quite interesting.
Sabine always asks interesting questions.
She's asking what kind of paint can be used with this 3D print. So if you are using a normal primer, you can use any paint you want. If you are using it for outdoor, the paint needs to be for outdoor usage. So there is no special needs for the paint. The UV gel can handle almost any paint. So yeah, it's not necessary to have a really special paint for that. Yeah.
And always primer is recommended.
Yeah, it's recommended. Yeah, but if you have like a special application and you already know that the object will be placed outside for a long time, you can also use a special coating to make UV the object coating stronger. Yeah. And yeah.
Okay, so yeah, I would like to thank Jordi to assist me here during this webinar. I hope you all found it very interesting. Can you go to the next slide, please? So let me thank everybody, and there were a lot of people listening. So thank you all for joining this webinar. Keep track on the Mimaki website for the next webinar. It might be not a 3D one, but we saw a lot of Mimaki family members all over EMEA, basically the world, logging in. So we have a survey at the end when we close down. So please fill in this survey. It will give us also some learning moments where we can improve or where we can do something different. And just mention your suggestions for the next webinar. Keep track on the website. There everything is mentioned, and in case if you have more questions later on or you want to personally get in touch with Mimaki, with myself, or with Jordi, which I recommend highly because he knows everything about 3D, then feel free, and you can use our website to get in touch and send out the request for more information or for personal contact. So thank you very much. Hopefully see you next time very soon, and bye bye for today. Have a nice day.